So today's topic is anticoagulant. Welcome to our class. We are going to study the anticoagulants. Let us see the classification of anticoagulants first. These are the drugs used to reduce the coagulability of the blood. They may be classified as in vivo. That means they can be used in the vivo, in the living state, and the second class is used as a in vitro. So in vivo, parenteral anticoagulants like heparin, then these heparins are again subclassified as low molecular weight heparin, heparinoids, heparin sulfate, then danaparide, then lepirudine, and ancrod. These are the different subclassification of heparin, the parenteral anticoagulant. Then next are oral anticoagulants coming under the class of in vivo anticoagulants. So oral anticoagulants are coumarin derivatives, bis hydroxy coumarin, dicarmarol, then warfarin sodium, warfarin sodium, acinocoumarol, and ethyl biscomo acetate. The name is ethyl biscomacetate. So these are the coumarin derivatives obtained from the coumarin steroid structure. So it is given the names as the suffix coumarin at the end. Then next is the indendione derivative. The example is phenindione. And the next class is the anticoagulants which are used in vitro, like heparin, also used in vitro as well as in vivo. So heparin is also used in the in vitro. Then second is the sodium citrate, used in the blood bank to store the blood. Whenever the blood is stored in the pouches in the blood bank, it is prevented or it is preserved in the presence of the sodium citrate as an anticoagulant. Then sodium oxalate is also used. Then sodium EDTA can be used full year. Sodium EDTA used as an anticoagulant in the laboratory. So let us see the one by one anticoagulants. First we will go with the parenteral anticoagulants, the heparin. So we will go with its actions. So who have discovered this? MacLean, a medical student, discovered it in the 1918, and it is named in the heparin. So Howell and Holt, 1918, named it in heparin. It occurs in the mast cell of the body and liver, intestinal mucosa. Then commercial heparin, porcine intestinal mucosa and bovine lungs. Means sometimes when we take the heparin, where we can get it from? Heparin is obtained from the sources like mast cells of the then liver and intestinal mucosa. Then from in the company, the heparin is obtained from the porcine intestinal mucosa and bovine lungs. Means it is also obtained from the porcine, that is the we can say the pigs. So pigs intestinal mucosa and bovine lungs, we can obtain the heparin. Then next is the heparin is a mixture of straight chain anionic glycosaminoglycan with a wide range of molecular weight. It is strongly acidic because of presence of sulfate and carboxylic acid groups. Then let us see the dissociation constant of heparin. Heparin is highly charged, thus it can cross the cell membranes and very poorly hence given parenterally. Means when we are using the heparin, you cannot take it by the oral way. Or why we are not able to take the heparin by oral route? Because it is having a very high charge and it cannot cross the cell membranes very easily. And the first pass metabolism effect is occur with the heparin, and the most of the heparin could get lost. So we have to give the heparin in the parenteral route, and at the low doses subcutaneously we have to give one the heparin. Then at high doses we can give the subcutaneously and intravenous injection. The heparin get metabolized in the liver, and half life depends on the dose. So this is all about the pharmacokinetic of the heparin. Let us see how the heparin is going to act on our body, and what is the mechanism of action of this heparin. Yesterday we also saw the two pathways in our body that are present to play a role in the coagulation of blood. So intrinsic pathway and extrinsic pathway is very much important. And in the intrinsic pathway, we also saw these are the factors which are get activated by the blood vessel injury, and extrinsic pathway which are get activated by the tissue injury. So the factors which are affected by the heparin are colored here in the brown color. So factor 12X, 12A, then 11A, then 9A, then 10A, and then thrombin. These are the factors which are get affected by the use of heparin, and we can get interfere with the coagulation process of the blood, and we can stop the process of coagulation of blood, and we can get the anticoagulant effect of the heparin here. So all this is done by the heparin. So vitamin K dependent factors affected by oral anticoagulant. So these are the factors which are yellow colored here. So the mechanism of heparin is easily shown here on this slide. You can see when the no heparin is there, active clotting factors, the process takes place slow, and inactive clotting factors forms. While heparin active clotting factors, then the heparin get activated and inactive clotting factors. So partially heparin inactivates the clotting factors. Generally, normally the blood coagulation process takes place in 2 to 3 minutes, and when the bleeding starts after 2 to 3 minutes, there is a starting the coagulation of blood. This is slow process. It may take sometimes 7 minutes, 10 minutes, or in the patients like which are having bleeding disorders, they can be having a very longer time of the coagulation. But in the patients where the patients which are having a early coagulating, means formation of thrombus and unnecessary formation of coagulation or clot of the blood shall be prevented by using the heparin. So we have to use the heparin in cases where the people's or patients are suffering with the clotting disorders, means unnecessary coagulation of blood takes place, and this unnecessary coagulation of blood shall be prevented by the use of heparin, so that our blood could flow through the blood vessels constantly for better transport throughout the body, and this will give the easy transport of the nutrition throughout the body. So here we can see the different molecular weight heparins, the low molecular weight heparin and the high molecular weight heparin. So molecular weight of high molecular heparin is the more than 30,000 Dalton, while the low molecular weight heparin has a 5,000 Dalton. Then biotransformation is low, then in the low molecular weight heparin high, then half life is shorter and depends on the dose in the high molecular weight heparin, while the low molecular weight heparin the longer independent dose. Then mechanism of action is inactive, inactivate both factors second A and 10A. While the LMW heparin, that is low molecular weight heparin, inactivate 10A factor. The anticoagulant effect is the high molecular weight heparins are more effective than the low molecular weight heparins. Here, this chart can easily remembered and can be compared with the high molecular weight and low molecular weight heparins. Then the adverse effects, the high molecular weight has no adverse effects comparative to low molecular weight heparin. So it has a chances of thrombocytopenia and long-term osteoporosis. The excretion is reticular endothelial system, and this cleared by the kidneys. Then we can say in the economical or affordability of the high molecular weight is not expensive. High molecular weight heparin is not expensive, while the low molecular weight heparin is expensive. Means it will cost more than the high molecular weight heparin. heparin induced thrombocytopenia. Once thrombocytopenia is determined, heparin must be stopped. Direct thrombin inhibitor should be given. Platelets must not be given because they will react with antibody already being produced against them, causing greater chance of thrombosis. So this is the heparin induced thrombocytopenia. Let us again first again cover with the previous part. Here you can see the mechanism. So this is the mechanism. Heparin acts very fast and it inactivates clotting factor very fastly. So these are the characteristics: molecular weight, high molecular weight heparin, low molecular weight heparin. So low molecular weight heparin are less effective than the high molecular weight heparin, but in the cost it is expensive. Low molecular weight heparin are the expensive one. So advantages are given here. The low molecular weight heparin are better absorbed subcutaneously, having more bioavailability, then longer and more consistent half-life. Once a daily subcutaneous administration can take place, then lower incidence of hemorrhagic complications, then lesser antiplatelet action and less interference with the hemostasis process. Then these are the therapeutic uses of heparin in the treatment of deep venous thrombosis, bedridden patients, old people, then post-stroke patient, in the patients with leg fractures, then elective surgery, then in the patients of ischemic heart diseases after angina or after myocardial infarction attack, then rheumatic heart diseases patients, then cerebrovascular diseases patients, then vascular surgery patients. These are the therapeutic uses of heparin. These are some adverse effects of heparin that we have to take care of. Then bleeding is most common one because heparin interferes with the hemostasis process of blood. Then allergy and anaphylaxis, then increased hair loss, and the thrombocytopenia is very much keen to observe in the patients with which are under the heparin treatment. Then long-term treatment can give the osteoporosis that may cause the spontaneous fractures in the patients. Then these are the some conditions where heparin can cause the thrombocytopenia. Then heparin in pregnancy, it not cause the placenta. It must be used instead of warfarin in case of requiring anticoagulant therapy in pregnancy. Heparin is safe than the warfarin. Warfarin can cause the placenta in the pregnancy time and can cause the changes in the fetus to produce the fetal warfarin syndrome, and that is not good. So we have to use heparin in replacement of the warfarin in pregnancy condition. Heparin cannot shall be contraindicated in hypersensitivity condition, then thrombocytopenia condition, then GI tract ulceration condition, threatened abortion, heparin shall not be used because the bleeding may increase in the condition. So we have not advised to use the heparin in this such conditions here. Then these are the antidote protamine sulfate. It is means sometimes the heparin can cause the bleeding and hemorrhagic condition. So we have to use the antidote to stop this condition of the bleeding. That is the protamine sulfate. So that is can be useful here. So protamine sulfate can be used as an anticoagulant because it interacts with the platelet fibrinogen and other clotting factors. So it makes them more than necessary. So it useful as an anticoagulant. So direct thromboplastin, direct thrombin inhibitors or heparinoids are useful as an anticoagulants again. So these are the, they bind to thrombin without additional binding proteins such as antithrombin protein, and they do not bind to the other plasma protein and give the higher action. So they are very useful and better than the heparin. They are called as the heparinoids. Then lapirudine is also useful as an anticoagulant. Then bivalirudine, it inhibits the platelet activation used in the percutaneous coronary angiography. Then ergotrobin, it is used in the heparin induced thrombocytopenia with or without thrombosis. Dose shall be reduced in the liver diseases patients. So here we will stop today in the anticoagulant section. Tomorrow we will see the oral anticoagulants. So these are the parenteral anticoagulants we also saw here today. So now I am sharing an attendance link here.